We are at Sibos and trying to talk to the world leaders in the area of payments business. I am currently standing at the Ripple stand with Mr. Naveen Gupta, the head of Middle East Asia Pack for Ripple. Naveen is going to share with us some very beautiful insights on how Ripple has garnered the support of over 250 global banks into its network and has transformed the way the payment is being made by some of these banks. Hello Naveen, welcome to FinBusiness. Let us have an interesting conversation on how you are going to transform the payment space. So Naveen, can you just share with us some insights about how the retail payment industry is progressing, especially on the back of blockchain and DLT payments? And how have you been working in the global markets and transforming the markets in the recent past?
Primarily in the space of cross-border payments, and there are three problems that we are solving. I mean, since our inception, so now we are 7 years old, we actually just turned 7 years last week. We are solving the problem of speed, because even today, the payments take time, and we can originate a payment or we can send a payment, but we don't know when it will reach the beneficiary. The second thing is around transparency, and transparency in multiple aspects. We don't know why a payment has not been delivered to the beneficiary. We have to constantly call the bank or call the institution to know where the payment is. The second thing is we don't know what the price of the payment would be upfront. So for example, if you have sent 100 dirhams, a lot of time you do not know what is the actual amount in rupees that will get delivered to the beneficiary. And what you want to know is you want to know the FX rate upfront. You want to know if any fee will be applied by the sending bank or the receiving bank. And you want to know what exact amount in INR will be delivered to Babu, so that you can make the best decision. You can let organizations compete for your business, and you can choose the one that gives you the best delivery in terms of customer experience and pricing for it to be delivered. Right? And the third thing that we want to solve for is the liquidity cost, so which is essentially the plumbing behind the banks, which requires pre-funding to be there within accounts, because of which the remittances become very expensive. So the digital asset story fits into the last part. So, and I'll just kind of back up a little bit to explain how the current plumbing among the organization works. So let's assume you walk into a bank in the UAE or anywhere in the world for that matter. What that bank essentially has done is it has kept very large amount of money in INR sitting with a local bank to essentially effect that payment onward to the beneficiary, right?
Correct.
Let's assume hypothetically, they have taken 10 million US dollars equivalent, converted them into Indian rupees, and kept that money with the bank B in India. Now, that liquidity itself has a cost, because it has a capital cost. Because as you know, a bank essentially is keeping the money there. It is foregoing the opportunity cost that it has for money in terms of lending. It has got the depreciation risk. So a PKR, INR, BDT, they keep depreciating, and hence the bank needs to manage that liquidity risk. And the third is operations cost. That means the treasury to do the FX trades and number of other things. And all these costs eventually get passed on to the customer. So a lot of time, as you know, there have been significant World Bank survey, which talks about that the cost of remittance is between 5 to 8%. Now that almost seems to be prohibitive, right? Prohibitive for somebody who's earning 200, 500 US dollars. Imagine 5% of your money gets taken away.
Correct.
And this is in a corridor that's very active. So we're talking about modern corridors. If you look at a corridor moving from Indian rupees to shillings, right, for example, an odd corridor in Africa, the cost can even be higher, right?
Correct.
So on a face of it, if you compare it, for example, Toyota, right, their margin itself is 7%. So a company with huge amount of capital investment, a Volkswagen, a lot of time their margin is sub 5%, seems to be making a small amount of money, whereas a remittance business itself takes away 5 to 8% of the total remittance that you're trying to make, right?
Correct.
So that means if you do 20 round trips, your principal is gone.
Correct.
Now, the reason, one of the big reasons there is because of this liquidity cost. So what we essentially have done is through digital assets solve this problem. So let me explain to you what it does. That means an institution on the sending side doesn't need to keep this pre-funded account, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what they're able to do is in real time, because let's take an example of UAE, and this is a hypothetical example because it's not live as yet, but let's assume if it was live, there is ADGM, Abu Dhabi Global Markets, enabled or licensed exchanges in the UAE. That means legally, you could walk into an exchange, give them your AED or US dollar, and then they will convert that into XRP. And this will happen with a licensed financial institution. So you would go to your usual financial institution that you would go to, they will accept that AED from you. But at the back end, what that financial institution will do is convert that money into XRP, real time, send that money in XRP over to Philippines, because Philippines is one market which we are already live today, for example.
Correct.
In that market, XRP will get converted into Philippines peso and the payout will happen. And the whole thing happens in less than 60 seconds, right?
Okay.
Which essentially means you don't have to have pre-funded accounts in Philippines peso. You are doing the settlement along with the transaction itself. You're sending the money underneath the message to pay from A to B for that $100 equivalent.
Correct.
Simultaneously. Now that relieves a huge amount of cost, because now you don't need pre-funded account. You don't need to manage depreciation risk. You don't need to manage treasury operations. And it suddenly gives the institution the ability to be far more competitive, right? It makes the country safer, because let's assume your home currency is AED, your home currency is US dollar, your home currency is euro. You're essentially asking the bank not to keep billions of dollars around the world, but essentially invest in your own economy. Because then the total amount of money that is needed by the bank to run a payment service operation dramatically decreases, right? So you're decreasing the cost dramatically from the way it is today. And hence you're able to have a better customer experience and offer a much better pricing to the eventual customer itself. And at the same time, not exposing the customer to any risk. So when Babu walks into that particular branch in the originating country, he would be given a guaranteed exchange rate, right? He would be told that, you know what, for us to do this transaction, it'll cost you X amount of money. So it's not that now Babu is exposed to any changes in the digital asset. It is within 30 seconds, the whole transaction gets completed.
What has been the resistance in the market for such kind of things? I'm sure a lot of regulators, compliance and stuff would come into picture.
Yeah.
So what is it that has been the kind of things that the banks have been slow about?
So first big thing is just education. Right. Whenever you have something new, for example, 20 years ago, internet was new, and you will constantly hear horror stories about people being cheated on the internet, not knowing who's contacting them, and just general kind of misuse, right? Because a lot of time, charlatans are the first one to take advantage of some of the new things that come out, right?
Correct.
And hence, education is the big thing, to essentially say, like, lots of time, people just think, hey, digital asset is volatile. It's moving up and down 50% a day. But if you look at, say, for example, over a period of time, actually oil is much more volatile than digital assets, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, if you just do an apple-to-apple comparison between two asset classes, right? But it is an education cycle. Anything that is new, it takes time for people to understand first, right? The second thing is enabling regulation, right? Because what we don't want is cross-border remittances is a regulated area. Then we need to make sure KYC is proper, AML, checks are essentially maintained. It takes an enabling framework for the originating institution to be able to take advantage, right, of this new technology that is available. But once he or she, the enabling institution, has the support of the regulator to essentially say, hey, here's the enabling framework, like what Abu Dhabi Global Markets has done, what the Central Bank in Philippines has done, what the Central Bank in Mexico has done, then both the sending and institution, receiving institution, feel comfortable that there is an enabling regulation that essentially exists, and within that framework I can operate, and I can of course share my results with the central bank, and then we can expand from there. So these are the two main things I would say. One is education, and one I would say enabling regulation.
What kind of ecosystem is required to make it much more faster and much more adaptable for all the banks and financial institutions?
So I think ecosystem that's really required is firstly exchanges, right? As you know, 24/7 exchanges, like it happens for other commodities markets around the world. We need enabling exchanges in that particular country. And then the second thing is enabling regulation. Assuming that you have these two main pillars available, then essentially financial institutions feel far more comfortable, because they have licensed institutions who are doing trading, not very different from national stock exchange or stock exchanges in the country, which are enabling infrastructure for the securities market, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing is the regulation to essentially say, hey, you know what, the same AML KYC compliance laws will apply to this new way of doing things as well. So just to give you an example, say for example, today you were to move from AED into US dollars into Indian rupee, or AED into US dollar into Philippines peso, you are allowed, right? The central bank doesn't put any restriction on you. You could do AED euro and Philippines peso. You can do AED GBP and into Philippines peso. The central bank essentially says, find the cheapest way forward, assuming that you are adhering to the regulatory guidelines on AML, KYC on both the sides. Now, let's assume that's the case, then you can use digital asset as a bridge as well. So it could be AED into XRP into Philippines peso, or it could be US dollars into XRP into Philippines peso. So using the bridge which generates the best value for you, which removes the need for pre-funding, there is, I mean, that should be fairly easy and very comprehensible for the banks, because today they use different bridge currencies depending upon what rate is available in the market and what's the liquidity situation.
Fantastic. So which are the countries where you have really had a strong foothold till now, and which are the areas where you are strongly eyeing and getting into now?
Yeah. So we already have 14 customers who are live, who are actively on an everyday basis using digital assets to bring value to their customers, right? So the corridors that we have opened is, for example, US dollar Philippines peso is already open, US dollar to Mexico is already open. There are a number of corridors between Eurozones are open, and then we are constantly working in our roadmap to open more corridors. Open more corridors in terms of countries, open more corridors in terms of currencies, and bringing new customers in. And what we see, a lot of time our first customers tend to be challenger banks or challenger institutions. I think that's the right word, right? Because these institutions are essentially saying, hey, I'm Babu Inc. I'm a new guy who essentially wants to create a new business model. Then you need to deliver some better value to Naveen that which I'm not getting today. So hence the challenger institutions tend to take market by their horns and essentially say, hey, we are ready to do something cheaper, faster, better. We are ready to give a customer experience at a price which is not available in the market today. And let's go and create dhamal in the market. Let's create a disruption in the market which doesn't exist today. But at the same time, complying by the letter and the spirit of the law under which they operate.
So what are the major concerns that the regulators across the world have talked to you about? And what do you have to say about that?
So I think the first biggest concern is just the myth. Right. So today, there is no, I'll be very upfront with you, there is no training school that the regulators go to. Right. Let's assume a new technology comes out. I think today, regulator is dependent on market participants like us who work very closely with the regulators to come and essentially say, hey, this has got nothing to do with Ripple. We want to explain to you how the fundamental technology works. What are some of the things it is good at, some of the things it is not good at? What are some of the use cases it will be successful at, right? And it needs to interact much more with the market participants on newer ideas that are coming in. And primarily from the amount of education, training, doing number of partnership workshops, doing a lot of time POCs. For example, we have done POCs with Bank of England, we have done quite a bit of work with SAMA, and then we work closely with the regulators. And sometimes it's a two-year process just for them to understand what is real, and what is speculation? What is real? What is myth? What is the underlying risks in the technology and the advantages of the technology? And what is just the media hype, right? Mm-hmm. And to be able to separate both those out. Once they're out, then you can work in with the regulator in the framework that they prescribe for you, because they understand it. They say, hey, Naveen, we are happy for you to work with us on this particular area, but this is the framework that you need to apply. These are some of the things that you need to report back to us once the initial pilot goes through. And then we are happy to work within that framework. But the key part is that education and making sure that it's on an ongoing basis between the regulatory and the industry cross collaboration.
So most of your interaction has been more from the retail payment side or more from the corporate banking side, and why is that?
Absolutely. So firstly, it has been both, but I would say it has been more retail and SME, right? Because there are certain enabling infrastructure that's required for this to happen. So one, for example, is liquidity, right? So today, digital assets are perfectly suitable for remittances, because what we are talking about is small value of payments, but the volume is huge. So we are talking about, say, $100,000 payments or $100,000, $1,000 payments. Also, what we find is that's the place where the fee charges are the highest, right? So for example, a GE or a Reliance or a Aramco pays a very different cost for their remittance, and the value of the remittance will be much, much higher versus, for example, a little guy on the street who has no bargaining power over the institution that he or she is using, right? And these are the people who intend to pay 5 to 8% of the remittance fee that's essentially going through. So that's perfectly suitable for a digital asset use case, because what we're talking about is very large number of payments that's happening, but at the same time, average value of the payments is very small. But over time, it will essentially move to the corporate side as well, but I think that's some way to go. As liquidity builds up on both the sides, that means exchanges essentially start doing a lot more transaction, higher value of transaction and higher volume of transactions.
With the global regulators, like including the World Bank or including IMF, being bullish about the way digital currency has to be adopted by the regulators as well of the world, where do you see businesses like Ripple going? Okay, because ultimately you have on one side the regulators wanting to adopt digital currency at a later date. Is it going to affect the business of Ripple in a different way?
So in our mind, the simple thing is let the best man win, right? Okay. Let's assume there is enabling infrastructure to essentially say, hey, you know what, within this framework, Babu, you can do business, Ripple, you can do business, and Z can do business. I think we are for that, right? We don't want anything that is specific to Ripple.
Okay.
So to say, hey, just approve Ripple, we are not for that. We are saying digital asset as a category or as enabling infrastructure should get approved. There should be a framework for that. Yeah. I think the simplest way to think about it is almost like the internet, right? Where the enabling provision has to be, internet is good. A lot of use cases can be built, and then there are different companies who compete to build the best use case. And there we are confident about our ability. Imagine in 2012, we are talking about use of digital assets to make remittances, right? So we have learned to crawl, we have learned to pick ourselves up, fall many times, walk, and then we have started to run. And we are very confident about our confidence, our ability to compete. And hence we don't want any special favors. All we want is the enabling provision for us to be there to be able to deliver the value.
It requires a lot of vision to think about digital assets for payments in the time like 2012, when the fintech ecosystem itself was taking off. How is the landscape for XRP in this current world now? How is it moving and what do you foresee?
So first of all, it is quite fantastic because now there are about 119 exchanges all over the world that list XRP. That means Babu as a user can essentially go to any one of these exchanges in lots of countries around the world and essentially trade in XRP, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that creates an enabling provision for us because they're market forces who are deciding the price, they're deciding the liquidity, they're deciding the usage, but that creates an infrastructure for the remittance to essentially happen. That means when institution A in a country wants to send money to institution B in a country, the necessary liquidity is there for the trade to happen at a very, very competitive price. And that's the where we are able to deliver value to the customer of this institution A and to the customer of this institution B. So to us, it is quite great the way XRP ecosystem is evolving. And then the second thing is our work with regulators is also bearing fruits, where now regulators have a much better understanding of digital assets. In most countries, we are seeing enabling provisions and enabling regulation coming out, which essentially saying, hey, you know what, within these rules and within this framework, you can go ahead and compete and deliver value.
See, one of the most important things in this is the fintech ecosystem.
Yeah.
Ultimately, that is also a strong framework which will help you to develop into the next thing. So how has been your experience with the fintech ecosystem? What are you trying to do to build up that fintech ecosystem in different parts of the world?
Absolutely. So let's take about something, a few specific things. So now there are 40 countries in the world that already have real-time payment system, are almost at the cusp of introducing real-time payment system.
Mm-hmm.
In every single country in the world, you take UAE, you look at KSA, which are the originating markets. You look at Bangladesh, you look at India, you look at Sri Lanka, you look at Pakistan. Almost all of them have a real-time payment system. So what you're fundamentally doing is taking a real-time payment system in the originating country A, connecting it with real-time payment system in the country B, with making sure if it's in the same currency, so let's say the US dollar is traveling, it essentially travels very seamlessly. If it is non-US dollar and FX is being done, then the best competitive way of doing FX in the middle, right? And you're putting it all together. And in this case, in a lot of cases, we are working with a fintech on the other side. So let's take an example of somebody like Cebuana, which delivers cash on the other side in Philippines. So it's a fintech which is reorganizing itself. And on the originating side, there could be another institution, because a lot of time the money will get delivered into a bank account, it will get delivered into a wallet, it will get delivered into some other mode which is approved by the government and or in cash as well, or in a prepaid card. And we essentially enable any kind of an output that connects in terms of the last mile connectivity. And lots of time these are owned by a fintech, right? So for example, when our Swell conference is happening, one of the keynote speaker is the CEO of Bcash, because Bcash in some way had transformed the wallet ecosystem in Bangladesh, for example, right? And similarly, on the originating side, the same things is happening as well. So to take an example, one of our customers in KSA is STCPay. STCPay is a financial arm of the largest telecom. So what you're saying is now you have traditional players, you have new players on the originating side, and similarly, you have traditional players and the new players on the last beneficiary mile. Last mile as well. and all at the same time offering better choices, better combination, better triangulation to Babu as a remitter, Naveen as a beneficiary, or Naveen as a remitter and Babu as a beneficiary.
So that ecosystem is being built up.
Absolutely.
Do you do any fintech activities or exercises to identify some of these top fintechs who can work with you on your platform?
Absolutely. So we have a few things. So firstly, we have got a great partnership team whereby we work with top fintechs to incorporate cross-border remittances into their solution itself.
Right. Okay.
So at some point, it will not be too hard. I mean, it's not there today, but let's assume you're buying anything from an e-commerce site. There is no reason for you to just buy it from India, for example. You can buy something from Korea and then you will be able to instantly remit money into that account in Korea for them to be able to dispatch the goods to you.
Correct.
So there are lots of this e-commerce is a big use case that we have identified in which Babu should be allowed without a prohibitive cost to buy anything from any e-commerce site, right? Because because today the shipping ability is available, but because of the friction in the cross-border payment system, a lot of time Babu is not able to essentially make that possible. We have international payroll. So for example, if you look at shipping companies all over the world, they want to pay their employees instantly because most of their employees are Indians, Filipinos, who are essentially working in those shipping companies.
Correct.
So there is a very large B2C use case where all these payrolls can be made instant and can be done at a very competitive price. Right? So there are lots of use cases that we are working on because what Ripple offers is enabling infrastructure, and then we are building use cases and applications on the top of it which people can benefit from, and in which fintechs are a big part, because a lot of time they are the processors or they are only already big players in the market.
And what about this SEC decision that is going to take place in the US? How soon do you expect that to happen?
So I do not know the specifics of it. I can check with our regulatory team to see what their view on this is, but what we are finding is all governments or all central banks are pro-regulations, right? In terms of what they're saying is, let's come up with an enabling provision for these guys to succeed. And I think that's what we've seen is the change of tune from 2 years ago when everybody talked mostly negative and primarily coming from the newspaper hype. Now essentially saying, we understand what value it delivers. Let's enable a framework for digital assets to be successful.
And what is your current stand, especially when it comes to India, how has been the response from the Indian banking sector towards Ripple and its solutions compared to last few years, and especially with the regulator seeing a big no-no to digital currency or cryptocurrency? How have you been working in this market and what is it that you expect?
Absolutely. So first of all, the Ripple tech stack works without digital asset.
Okay.
Just in terms of the fiat itself, so somebody, for example, Rack Bank is live with Access Bank, Rack Bank is live with Cargill's in Sri Lanka, and there are a number of other institutions which are live as well. You could essentially transfer a fiat and into an Indian rupee without use of any digital asset, and the same tech stack can be used. So there is no reason that digital asset is compulsory to be used. So for example, in markets like India, there is no use of digital assets. And we have a number of banks who are live. Axis Bank is live, IndusInd is live, Kotak is live, Yes Bank is live, Federal Bank is live. And every day we are delivering on a BAU basis, making remittances transparent, making remittances fast, almost instant in terms of real time, and making them transparent and making them reducing the cost of errors that were earlier in place without use of any digital asset. So the tech already works, right? Now, in terms of the next step, for Indian government to consider potential use of digital assets, there is a lot of work to do, right? So we are already working with, for example, the enabling provision in Philippines, in Mexico, where the number of immigrants are similar to like India. In India, right? So maybe at some point, once we prove large in a very stable manner, use cases in other countries, we'll take our findings to institutions in India and essentially show them. And then it's for the Indian government to decide what is the best for non-residents who are living overseas.
Interesting. So it is work in progress as
absolutely. But it's again a journey of education. We always work with the regulators. We make sure that they understand both the benefits and the risk inherent in the technology and let them at the right point choose what is right for the citizens in the country.
Interesting. And then any technology, there is a what you call as a runway time.
Yeah.
There is a takeoff and there is a tipping point and then there is a takeoff. So where is Ripple right now?
we believe that we are at that tipping point, right?
Okay.
The only thing that I would say is, for us, it's very hard in any technology, particularly when you're on the inside, to know that will that tipping point happen in the next 3 days or 3 months, or it may take another 6 months. So we are there because we have now almost 250 institutions which are part of Ripple, right? Every day we are opening new corridors, we are delivering value to our customers, and they indeed to their customers. In fact, if you Google Ripple, you will find lots of places where instant cross-border remittance is being enabled by Ripple, right? So from our point of view, I think we are focused on customer experience, we are focused on delivering value, and yeah, we are getting closer and closer to it.
So how soon or in the near future can you see a very strong mainstream adoption?
So I would say in certain corridors, we are already mainstream. So I would say in, for example, Middle East to South Asia corridor, we are already mainstream, mm-hmm. right? So if you look at the top four banks in Saudi, they are our customers. You look at top four banks in Kuwait, they are our customers. Number of institutions like UAE, Extract Bank in the UAE are our customers, right? They're only all mainstreams. What is happening is within those institutions, we are converting more and more corridors, right? So for example, you always start with one corridor. So with UAEX, we started with UAE to Thailand as a corridor. And then now we are opening more corridors with that. With number of banks in KSA, we started with Saudi to Indian rupees as a corridor. And now we are opening more and more corridors with us. So there is a journey of bringing more customers on board, but there is also a journey to make sure that 100% of all corridors within ascending institutions are on Ripple. And some of it, as you know, integration, technology work takes a little bit more time.
Interesting. It's very interesting to note all these developments. Yeah. And I soon see a lot of scope for at least being an early starter and a market innovator. There is definitely a lot of scope for Ripple to quadruple in the market and create probably a tsunami like our friend was talking, your earlier CEO. He had spoken at one of the Sai bosses. He said Ripple is set to set a tsunami in the market.
No, we are working hard every day, each one of us. That's what we think about, to deliver value to our customers every single day. We are a very customer-centric institution.
Fantastic. Awesome. Wish you all the best.
Thank you very much, Babu. Pleasure.